In this final lecture module, we'll just tie off a few loose ends and we'll finally be done. So Goldman wants to finish the paper by introducing and accounting for a distinction that's fairly current in epistemology or common in epistemology, a distinction between ex post justification and ex ante justification. So ex post justification occurs when there exists a belief and we say that belief is or isn't justified. Ex ante use occurs when no such belief exists and when we wish to ignore the question of whether such a belief exists. Here we say of the person, independent of his or her doxastic state vis-a-vis that proposition, that P is or isn't suitable for them to believe. So the idea is, what would you be justified in believing regardless of whether or not you believe it? I'll capture that with my notion of an ex ante. Anti-justification. My notion of whether or not you are actually justified about beliefs that you actually have, I'll capture that with the ex post notion. So how does Goldman do that? In 11, he tells us, person S is ex ante justified in believing P at T if and only if there's a reliable belief-forming operation available to X, which is such that if S applied that operation to his or her total cognitive state at T, S would believe P at T plus delta for a suitably small delta, and that belief would be ex post justified. So at this point, Alvin ends the paper. He forgot to include his closure clause, but he gave us a base clause, a recursion clause, and he tried to deal with some potential difficulties that he's anticipating people might raise with that base clause and recursive clause. So he's done quite a bit of work here. I think the interesting and important idea that we have isn't an idea that's really original to Alvin, really probably dates to Armstrong. The idea, though, is that I'm not going to be able, from within my own cognitive states, be able to establish a relationship between myself and the world simply in virtue of what accessible to me via my cognitive state. So when I believe something, the status of that belief in relationship to the world isn't something that I'm directly privileged to. When I have an experience of redness, whether or not there's really something that corresponds to that in the world, again, something I'm not privileged to. If I have an assessment of my evidence, how likely something is, right, my subjective certainty about something, I'm not, just in virtue of that feeling or that sense of certainty, given any privileged access into how accurately that reflects the real evidential relationship in the world. How do I deal with that? Well, the way Alvin suggests we deal with it, the way Armstrong suggests we deal with it, the way externalists suggest we deal with it, is we start talking about that relationship between the world and the cognizer. And Alvin says it's not just that relationship. We can talk about necessary relationships between a belief being true and being believed. And what we really want is to understand the relationships between the world and the person in virtue of which they get into the systematic, regular set of belief forming processes that are justifying in virtue of the fact that they tend to produce true beliefs and they tend not to produce false beliefs. So they regulate the interactions that I have with the world. Now, this is an interesting and important change, but it's not one that people accept without resistance, nor is it as trivial to seamlessly develop this view into a full-fledged epistemology as Alvin's paper might suggest.